we interrupt your regularly scheduled programming for an announcement live from the Oval Office from President Roosevelt himself.
There is danger ahead. Danger against which we must prepare. There can be no reasoning with an incendiary bomb. We know now that a nation that can have peace with the Nazis only at the price of total surrender.
History Hatters. Well, today, the Carnegie Institution of Washington hosts lectures, special events, and even serves as a terrific wedding venue. In 1940, when the world was in turmoil and America stood on the brink of war, the Carnegie Institution leased its space to the Office of Scientific Research and Development, chaired by the Carnegie Institution's president,
Dr. Vannevar Bush. Shortly after Germany invaded France in May 1940, Bush recognized America and its allies faced a technologically superior opponent. On his own, Bush lobbied President Roosevelt with a one-page plan to form a committee to research topics of warfare neglected by the military. The Carnegie Institution served as the committee's base of operations, even poaching some of the institution's existing staff. Bush abandoned the president's office upstairs and relocated to a more imposing space. Imagine entering the rotunda as a new hire. We would head towards a side room where Bush's personal secretary controlled traffic. If cleared for entry, we would enter through this door. Now we find ourselves inside an immense oak-paneled boardroom. All the way across the room, we discover America's first wartime science advisor seated at his desk. Bush challenged newcomers with a bit of role play. You are about to land at dead of night in a rubber raft on a German-held coast. Your mission is to destroy a vital enemy wireless installation that is defended by armed guards, dogs, and searchlights. You can have with you any one weapon you can imagine. Describe that weapon. Bush sought to imbue newly recruited scientists with a realistic sense of how their research would support vital wartime efforts. Just 6 days after Germany invaded the Soviet Union, on June 28, 1941, Bush again successfully lobbied the president to establish the Office of Scientific Research and Development. The OSRD, which Bush again chaired, enjoyed greater autonomy than his prior committee and received direct funding from Congress to develop prototype devices without the consent of the military. From the institution's boardroom, Bush oversaw 30,000 workers across the country who developed anti-submarine inventions, fire control devices, a variety of vehicles, an improved bomb detonator called the proximity fuze, vast advancements in radar, and the most revolutionary, destructive, and horrific weapon ever devised, the atomic bomb. In documents obtained from the institution, the United States government established the OSRD headquarters out of the institution's administration building under a license arrangement. The institution donated all of its space without cost to the government. To make full use of the location, OSRD sought to convert the institution's auditorium into temporary office spaces. Although OSRD initially weighed housing workers within the rotunda as well, there's no documentation this was ever done. They even hired the same construction superintendent, Mr. Edward Burnap, who oversaw the institution's 1938 renovations designed by the architectural firm Delano & Aldrich. It's difficult to imagine this beaux-arts marvel repurposed to develop transformative tools of war, so I asked the institution's help in locating any photographs of these converted spaces in this episode, but they confirmed none exist. This makes sense given the nature of their classified work. However, the institution was able to share that the Secret Service mandated the first floor windows be covered with grills, the building be guarded at all times, and the bronze portico off 16th Street be closed to visitors. People passed by the Carnegie Institution every day without any sense of the critical role it played in fulfilling President Roosevelt's ambition.
We must be the great arsenal of democracy.
I would like to thank the Carnegie Institution of Washington and its staff for extending the many courtesies to make this episode of The History Hat possible.
Subscribe by clicking on the History Hat logo to continue to explore the mysteries of history.